Session, and it's my pleasure and honor to introduce Professor Peter Uth Jepsen from University of Denmark and Department from Photonics Engineering. So he's a leader of ultra-fast and infrared terrestrial science. But my introduction, it will start from the book, which I have in my hands. It's Peter's PhD thesis, defended in 1996, and I have copied it from Frankfurt Laboratories, because this was one of the most valuable books needed for terahertz labs. And usually showing for my PhD this how PhD thesis should be written, because it contains many technical details. It's a huge collection of formulas, numbers, and derivation of different type of sensitivity numbers and something like that. Even contains principles of molecular physics, which shows when terahertz the signals are so small, how you can resolve it from the relatively noisy system. So that Peter did in Denmark. Then he moved to Freiburg. He was a postdoc for certain years, and he made, in Freiburg, he made a number of interesting works dedicated to vibrational modes in bulky molecules, also freshly recorded spectra of DNA molecules, both in room and liquid helium temperatures. And also after return to Denmark, he became a professor and still working in challenging topics. You know, terahertz and what are big enemies, but Peter is not obstacle for Peter. He made interesting works on sugar solution reflection, terahertz time domain spectroscopy. Also now he is working on ultrafast optic and room temperature ballistic graphene devices, mapping of graphene layers. And also one of his topics is extreme nonlinear terahertz optics in metals. So at last but not at least, he applied terahertz spectroscopy for painting investigation. I don't know what will be touched today, but it's interesting work just appeared a year ago, which dedicated to frangelico paintings and getting insights in Franciscan triptych. So fantastic topics, fantastic application. I don't know how detailed will be to touch this topic, but I'm sure that your talk will be absolutely interesting and amazing for all of us.
Thank you very much for that very, very kind introduction. We just talked about that when you write your thesis, don't write it just to graduate. Write it because you know that someday somebody picks it up and says, why did you write this 20 years or 30 years later? It's a little bit frightening. Okay. Yes, I will try to, and thank you for the suggestion for the title. It's a very good title, I think. It's not my own idea. I will try to give some examples of the work that we have been doing in the past years about terahertz science and technology. The names on the bottom are the funding agencies. I should just show that right away so I don't forget it afterwards. But let's just get started. And also normally show this slide first so I don't run out of time and don't show it afterwards. It's the many of the wonderful people who have been involved in this work. It's my own group, the top people there, or the people shown on top there. And part of the work I will show today is a collaboration with SLAC, Matthias Hoffmann, one of my former students, and some material science from Purdue with the group. And I work very closely with one of my neighboring departments of the DTU nanotechnology department, where they work a lot with graphene, and we have used our terahertz technology to investigate graphene with. So all the things I'll be talking about today is about ultrafast. You heard, I didn't hear it myself, but I dare to say that it was a wonderful talk you heard yesterday about femtosecond technology. So all the laser technology that we are working on is basically a very simple version of what you heard yesterday. It's just commercial femtosecond lasers. We have done nothing special to them, but we just use them as the tool, the very short pulse that we can use to generate the terahertz radiation with. And this is a picture from our lab that some good photographer took a little while ago. I tried just for fun. I heard about this Deep Dream network from Google where you can submit a picture and then it does something to it and it makes it very organic. So I tried to take a picture and send it through Google Dream, Deep Dream, and you can see that, well, it's not so easy to see, but there's a lot of fantastic creatures popping up if you look at a lab in the right light. The brightness doesn't really do the detail any good here, but there's a lot of nice animals everywhere there. Okay, so I will talk about ultrafast terahertz science and technology. What is that? I'll, of course, try to get through that. But basically, some of the topics that we are working on are popping up in the circle here, where we are basically using terahertz light for a lot of things. I'm a terahertz spectroscopist, so if I should put it a little bit provocative, I would say that it doesn't really matter what we put in the beam as long as it's something cool. So I'm not a graphene person. I'm not focused on a specific material or a specific material problem. I'm focused on what can we use terahertz light for. So some of the things we have been working on is terahertz imaging in the real world, I call it here, sensing. So terahertz and sensing in the real world. We work a lot with nonlinear optics. All the generation processes we use rely on that. We work with vacuum electronics. So basically, how can we control electrons flying around in vacuum? What can we use that for? We work a lot with investigating conductivity, so electrical conductivity. That links a little bit to plasmonics, which is also part of it. We work with vibrational modes and phonons in materials, nonlinear plasma physics, which is also part of the generation process. We work with nano-optics of 2D materials, which is linked very much to conductivity and plasmonics up here. Liquid relaxation dynamics sounds very fancy, but it basically is about what is inside this bottle here. If we take a terahertz beam, reflect it off the bottle, can we then say something about what is inside? And yes, that's possible. It might be easier just to drink it and find out, under certain circumstances, that's not the best way of finding out what's inside a bottle, of course. We work also a little bit, or some of my colleagues work with ultra-high-speed wireless communications, where we try to use terahertz carrier waves to encode an enormous amount of information basically on a wireless link. I think they have made a link now that goes to 260 gigabits per second or something like that wireless. But this is not my own work, so I cannot take much credit for that. But today I will try to give some examples of some of these things here. I can of course not cover the whole thing, that would be super tiring for you at least. But I will give some examples of terahertz imaging, terahertz spectroscopy, and then use terahertz as a hammer. What do I mean by that? I mean make a very intense terahertz pulse, shine it onto something and see what happens. That way of doing science has sort of that has been my way of thinking about it for a long time, because I know something about optics, but material science is not my specialty, so I'm always excited when something happens, when you put light on a material, and I like this excitement, because if it's not exciting, it might be relevant, but if it's not exciting, then it's not so much fun doing it. So, very, very briefly, the terahertz region, at least if you plot it in this way, in the middle of the spectrum. Of course, you can plot it in any biased way you want. But we are talking about frequencies that are in the terahertz region. 1 terahertz is 1,000 gigahertz. It's very high frequency microwaves, you could call it. It's a wavelength of 300 micrometers, so it's very long wavelength optics. So it's in that ballpark. 1 terahertz. A photon with 1 terahertz frequency has a photon energy of 4 millivolts. And of course, 1 terahertz corresponds to an oscillation period of 1 picosecond, 10 to minus 12 seconds. So just to make sure that you all know where we are in the spectrum. Terahertz spectroscopy, in the general scheme, one can show a drawing like this here that basically illustrates the different ways one can do terahertz spectroscopy if you use these very short sub-picosecond pulses. And the whole thing starts with a femtosecond laser that comes in here. You can see that I've not shown that laser. I don't really care about it. It just has to deliver me the short femtosecond pulses. And then it's a time domain technique, so all our measurements are based on measuring the time-resolved trace of this terahertz signal. So we split the femtosecond beam up in several portions. One portion on the first beam splitter here is used to trigger some terahertz generator here, generates a short pulse of terahertz radiation. It propagates through the optical system here, through a sample here, and then we detect the temporal shape of the terahertz signal over here. And this is done by using a detector scheme that is gated by a second portion of the same femtosecond pulse. And then we can, with the time delay here, we can basically vary the timing of the terahertz pulse with respect to the probe pulse, and then map out, basically optical sample, the shape of the field. Then we can, if we want to, but I'm not going to talk so much about that today, we could split off a third portion of the laser beam here, pump the sample at a specified time, and then probe with a well-defined timing afterwards what are the terahertz properties. So pump and probe spectroscopy. We use three different ways to generate and detect terahertz radiation in my lab, and this is what is used. Is almost all labs doing the same type of work. We can use photoconductive switches, which is a little semiconductor structure here with a bias voltage on. A femtosecond laser pulse shorts the gap here, drives a very short transient current, which radiates a terahertz pulse. This is what you hopefully can see here. And the sort of the way to measure the terahertz pulse with the same technique is to have a similar semiconductor structure. We can gate it with a femtosecond pulse. If it arrives at the same time as the terahertz field here, then we have carriers generated here. We have an electric field, so we can drive a current. And that current we can measure, and this is our measurement signal. We can also use electro-optic crystals, so nonlinear crystals, where a laser pulse drives the crystal so hard that we get terahertz radiation out of it. It's by this process here. So basically, the optical rectification of the laser pulse here generates a short terahertz pulse. And there's a technique that is also based on a similar crystal for measuring the pulse shape. This is called free space electro-optic sampling, where you basically make use of that the crystal can become birefringent if you apply a field. So that's the Pockels effect, right? So if the terahertz field is present in the crystal at the same time as a probe pulse, the probe pulse, the phase of the, or the polarization of the probe pulse can be rotated a little bit, and this we can pick up optically and measure the field strength in that way. And the last method we are using is something we call, or has been called in the field, has been called air photonics, because it doesn't rely on a material except air to generate the terahertz radiation. Here we have a medium, here we have a semiconductor, here we have a nonlinear crystal, but here we just have air. The air we breathe works wonderful. You just take very strong laser fields, and it works fine if it's a two-color field. You make a plasma channel here by the strong pulses, so this requires a very strong laser, a millijoule-class laser. You make a plasma channel here, and then the electric fields of this combined two-color field here drives a nonlinear photocurrent, basically, in the plasma that also radiates a terahertz pulse. And there's a mechanism over here, which is also based on the same principle that can be used to measure the terahertz field shape in this way here. If you want to know anything about it, come and ask me. I'm here for the rest of the day and tomorrow also, but I don't have time to give you all the dirty details here. But these three mechanisms all generate a very short terahertz pulse. They have different qualities depending on what type of mechanism you use. The photoconductive switches generate these. This is just an example. They can look differently in shape here. But it's a single cycle pulse of the electric field. The pulse energy is very low in the femto to picojoule range, so very, very weak pulses. But because of this gated detection, we can still measure those pulses with a very high signal-to-noise ratio. The organic crystals, the nonlinear crystals here generate stronger pulses. They approach the microjoule range, so many orders of magnitude stronger, but with similar bandwidth, typically, or with similar pulse shape. And then this air photonics technology here, because there's no medium involved except air, there's no phase matching conditions, there's no velocity mismatch in these things. So the pulses can become very, very short and very, very broadband with pulse energies that actually, the example shown here is not super high, but actually this technique can be pushed also to the microjoule range and probably even more if one wants to. And here is a summary of the spectra of these pulses here. This is just the Fourier transform. So you can see this is frequency on a log scale. This is the spectral energy density, so microjoules per terahertz. And you can see the photoconductive switches are down here, very nice, smooth spectra, but not very high power. The organic the nonlinear crystals, typically have the same bandwidth, but much higher power. You can see that there are many orders of magnitude from here to up here. And the air photonics technique here basically gives a very, very broad spectral coverage. So that's the difference between these different methods. Okay, I will go through a few examples now. You will see some pictures of life underwater. This is not really related to the topic, but it's just nice. So first I will talk about terahertz imaging. I call it hidden secrets because the whole thing is about, can we look into materials and find out about things we cannot see by the naked eye or camera. There's actually a nice feature article about this in the recent optics and photonics news from OSA, where you can read more about it. It's one of my former students who is the sort of main focus of that article. Here are some examples of terahertz imaging. What can we do? This is a random random article from our lab. It was a printer cartridge for one of these label printers because it didn't have any metal surrounding it, or so it's just plastic layers. This is an iPhone 4S. This was before it was metal on the back, so we could see the whole way through, see what is inside there. And the last example is some armor material, which are ceramic tiles that sit on a metal background or metal plate. And the important thing here is to have those ceramic tiles glued perfectly to the surface. Otherwise, it's not strong enough. So you can see that the two surfaces rotating here is the front surface of the tiles and the back surface, all seen from the front. And if we are lucky, then over here on this side here, you can see some defects popping up here now. That one can see in this way. So how does this work? If we have a layered structure, this is now an example from a painting, then a typical painting consists of many layers. You can have a support layer if it's like a panel painting, for instance, there can be wood. There's a ground layer. There may be some underdrawings that you want to find out about what is behind the Mona Lisa. Did they paint something nice before that? There's, of course, the paint layer itself, and then there's a varnish layer on top. And different optical techniques, of course, if you want to inspect a painting, you have a whole battery of techniques to look at it. And you can do visible photography, then you just get like a picture of the picture, clearly. If you go to the infrared region, you can see a little bit deeper. You can typically see deeper into the paint layer, and maybe typically not, but at least you can see a different contrast at least. If you use reflectometry, thermography, then you can see deeper again. If you use UV light, which is also used, then you see just the top layer, but then you can see the quality of the varnish layer. If you use X-rays, wonderful technique, then you can see the whole way through. And then if you're lucky, there's some contrast between the painting and something you want to find, but it's not given. Maybe that there is, but the general thing is that you see through the whole thing. You get like a transmission image of the whole thing. You cannot see at which depth things are. If you use terahertz imaging, then you get somewhere in between visible infrared imaging and X-ray in terms of depth penetration. And since we have these short pulses, we can actually separate the different layers. It sounds a little bit contradictory that terahertz lies between visible and X-ray, but this is not in terms of wavelength, this is in terms of penetration depth. So it works this way. We have We have a reflection geometry where we send terahertz pulses onto the surface and detect the shape of them as they get reflected over here. So if you have this interface structure that I've shown over here, then you can have a terahertz pulse hitting it, the surface, then you get a an echo from the top surface, you get an echo from the next layer, you get an echo from the last layer, and then you get some transmission. And in time, in the reflection geometry, you will get a signal back looking something like this. This is a time of flight image, basically, or time of flight scan. So you can read out what is the difference in timing between the different peaks, and that tells you what is the depth of the different layers. And the amplitude of the peaks here tells you about what is the refractive index contrast between the different layers, basically. So this is very, what should I say, this is very qualitative, that okay, we can read off the distances here, and then we can tell about the layer thicknesses. This can be done in an automated way by basically global data fitting. So there, I just took in one example of that here. This is a reflection measurement from a three-layer structure. Just, okay, if you want to demonstrate something very quickly, then you go to your lab and see what do I have standing around, a bottle of water or USB stick or something like that. But in this case here, we just took a one of these old school transparencies that we used before PowerPoint. And then on each side, I put on a little paper, what is it called, a paper label that you use for letters and stuff like that. They glue on each side, so I have three layers. Paper, polymer, paper. And then I measured a reflection, the blue line here, or the blue signal is a reflection from metal surface, and the red line is a reflection from this structure here. And you can see that, okay, there's a complicated structure here that relates to the three different layers here. If we look at the spectra of these two pulses here, just the Fourier transforms, we get the reference here, so the metal reflection looks like this here, and the reflection from the layered structure looks like this mess here. So you see all these interferences give these basically ripples in this the spectrum. But we can actually come up with procedures, and it's not us who came up with that, but there's a very nice paper here from Kaiserslautern who wrote about that. You can do a global optimization of the problem. Basically, you need to write up a model for the reflection of the different layers, and then you can fit the reflected signal to that, or fit the model to that reflected signal. You see here a comparison between the measurement, that's the blue dots, and the fitted pulse that should be reflected from a three-layer structure like this. That's the red line. Fits pretty well, doesn't it? I can say that without bragging, because it's not me who came up with the principle here. But it works very well, and this allows us to be quantitative and tell how thick are the different layers here. And you can see it fits very well. We measured with a ruler that the stack was 491 microns, plus minus something we don't really know, because it's just a mechanical thing, right? And the fitting here gave us 489 microns. It fits pretty well. So it's possible to be quantitative here, which for painting may not be super important, but if you want to use this in quality control or something like that, it is actually quite important. Good, terahertz imaging. We do that, of course, by doing the same measurements as I showed you on the previous slides, which was just one point, and then we just raster scan around here and measure the reflected signal at each pixel. And then we get this voxel data set, so an XY coordinate, and then the third axis is the time axis, right? And then we can just process each pixel individually. There might be faster ways of doing this, but this is very precise. There's a photo here of a campaign that we did in Florence a few years ago, where you can see the scanner at work. So I show one example here. This is a little bit dark, but this is a painting from, did I put the year on? I forgot that, sorry. It's from, 1797 here. It's an oil painting on canvas at the National Gallery of Denmark that we got the chance to work on. And this is the visible image. It's the dying Messalina and her mother. Yes, and that's very sad. But if we take an X-ray image of this painting, it looks like this here. So you can see that there's a gentleman sitting here on the wrong angle, basically. So apparently this canvas, in the old days, canvases were very expensive. So they were reused. If the first painting looked like crap, then they just painted another one on top of it, right? I don't know if this looked bad, but apparently that the artist didn't like it, or they bought it secondhand or something, that canvas. I have no idea. Okay, so if we now overlay the visible and the X-ray image, it looks like this. And then if we now take the X-ray part out here, you can see that the face of this man lies on top of the mother of the dying young lady there. So if we now take the terahertz image, the terahertz reflection image, it looks like this here. It looks very much like the X-ray, right? But you can see we have like an interplay here between the image of the man and the image of the mother's arm here. You can see, I thought at first that the man had some kind of weird hat on, but it turns out to be, you can see the mother's arm here, right? Like this. So it would be interesting if we could somehow, because the mother's arm is painted on top, right? That's the painting. And the man behind is deeper down. So maybe we could actually separate them. This is what we tried to do here. These are mechanical cross sections. So this is a painting that got restored. So we had access to very tiny cross section photographs over here. So we actually knew what the structure was, and that was important in order to sort of calibrate our measurements. So, and this is the corresponding terahertz reflection image in a cross section. So this is just the white line shows a terahertz pulse measured at 1 pixel, and then this color scale here basically shows that profile scanned across the painting. We can clean it up a little bit so it looks like over here. So we can do either invasive cross sections over here with a knife, or we can do non-invasive cross sections here. We get sort of the same, well, we get information about the depth profile out in both cases. So if we do that, then we can start to separate the different layers. So you have one example here. This is a terahertz trace. And then if we single out this piece here, then we get the top layer. This is now rotated so we can see the face of the man oriented, right? And this is, it's not perfect, but you can still see the man here and you can see the arm up here. But if we now take the next layer, we actually get a much clearer image of the man without the arm up here. If we go on further down, then we get the interface between the between the underdrawing and the ground layer. We get the interface between the ground layer and the canvas. We get the interface between the canvas and a restoring canvas that was placed on the back in 2001. And then we get the backside of that canvas here. So we can slice it slice by slice by slice. We can actually just scroll through basically with the mouse wheel and see what is inside. We can also, I think I'll actually skip this because the colors are not very good, but we can now, since we have this broadband terahertz signal, we can go in and color code it. So we take a certain frequency band and represent that as red, another as green, and a third as blue. And that gives us sort of false color images that we can learn more about. And I'm not going to try to convince you that we can see something there because it's very dark, but we actually learn something about the different, you know, stroke techniques by the painter and stuff like that, that I don't know anything about, but the people at the museum thought it was pretty cool. Good. Last example of this is a campaign that we did last summer. This is a student I had from Iran, and she scanned the painting that you can see in the back here. I'm showing you this picture because it's a nice photo, but also because then you can see how big the painting is. And we scanned the whole painting pixel by pixel and tried to learn something about it. It's a painting from, so that's the reflection signal from that specific painting from 1 pixel. And what you see here is a photograph of the painting over here, and then you see a zoom out of the same painting. Just to give you an impression about the amount of data that comes out of such a scan here. You see the individual pixels here, so each of those is a time trace. And then when we zoom out, we get the whole picture, and what you see first is just the front surface, and then I zoom in through the painting after, so we can see the different layers there. So if you want to, you can really collect a lot of data and tell the people who own the painting or who wants to learn about it, what's inside it. Good. Okay, so that was sort of real-world imaging. And now, written on top of the nice octopus there, it says hidden secrets number two. And this is now conductivity mapping of monolayer graphene. Change of topic completely. But the interesting thing is that it's exactly the machine that we had in Florence and had at many different places scanning paintings. This we also use to look at graphene. So switching from very, very applied science to more fundamental research. So again, the question is, if you have an image of a hand, what's the first thing you do? You go and take an x-ray. First thing you think about whenever you see a hand, you take an x-ray of it, right? Maybe not. But anyway, it reveals what is inside if you take an x-ray image. And the same thing we have worked on for quite a few years, trying to see if we could use the same technique to look into the qualities of graphene. You heard in the morning here, you heard about graphene, and you, no doubt, you have heard a lot about that graphene is the most wonderful material in the universe. It has a bright future in front of it. And we will see how long time it takes before we get to the future. But nevertheless, it's an interesting technological challenge to find out about what are the electrical properties of graphene without damaging it. Normally, if you want to measure how conductive graphene is, then you put on electrodes and you pass a current and read a voltage or something like that. But then you have already put contacts on, and that means that graphene cannot be used for anything else anymore. So we want to do the same thing as with the paintings, look at the material without damaging it and tell people what they want to know about it. So basically make a terahertz image instead of the photograph and learn about what is the conductivity, what is the number of carriers, what is the scattering time, what is the sort of fundamental parameters. And the way we do this is actually also very much like the paintings. We have a sample here, or substrate. This could be silicon with SiO2 on top. Then we pass the terahertz pulse through. We get a lot of echoes because there are multiple reflections everywhere. Then we have a region with graphene. Do the same thing. We pass the terahertz pulse through. We get another sequence of echoes out from the multiple reflections. And then we get signals out that look suspiciously like the reflection from a painting, but it's not. And you can see the difference between the graphene transmission and the bare substrate transmission is small, but it's there. And this is what we use to extract the properties. You can write up some equations for this, but the main message I want to give you is that by measuring the transmission as function of frequency, then you get information about the conductivity as function of frequency. And the conductivity spectrum is actually what you get out of such a measurement. You can fit your model of conductivity to that spectrum and learn whether your model is correct or not. And this is basically what's needed. This is, for instance, the values up here. This is the DC conductivity popping up here. And the shape of the fitted spectrum here, this tells us about the scattering time and things like that. The alternative way to measure conductivity or sheet conductance is to use probes that touch the surface, and then you pass current through and measure voltages and things like that. This is called micro four-point probing. We are working together with a company, small Danish company called CAPRIS, Copenhagen Applied Research. The name doesn't say much, but what they do is that they make these big automated machines that can do this four-point probing with small cantilever-based probes that they can bring into very gentle contact with the surface and then find out about what is the conductance. So we have a perfect opportunity here to compare a standard method here, state-of-the-art method here, with our non-standard terahertz spectroscopy tool. There's a sample here. I don't show you the real sample, but this is a graphene piece of really low quality, I must admit, but it's a few years ago. It's 4 millimeters long here, so 4 by 6 millimeters or something. And each of these dots is a four-point probe measurement with this four-point probe technique. So this took a long time doing. It took the guy who did it, it took him the whole weekend, Friday to Sunday. 4,000 approaches with the tips, and it worked wonderful, but it took a while. And if we now put the terahertz, the corresponding terahertz image on top, you can see that actually it you can see it's the same sample. You can see the same features, like there's a hole in the conductivity here, there's another hole here, but it's not exactly the same. For instance, this is all black, so no conductance, and here it's not all black, so there's some, so there's similarities and differences. And we have spent a lot of time, a lot of long nights thinking about what is the difference here, what are the similarities and what are the differences, can we quantify that? And I show you one diagram of that here. So this is a plot that shows the, from the previous map, shows all the terahertz conductivity values of each pixel along this axis here, and all the micro four-point probe values shown up here. And that gives this sort of correlation diagram here. If the two measurement techniques were identical, giving the same results, all points would lie on the diagonal here, right? The terahertz conductivity is always the same as the micro four-point probe one is. Clearly it's not. Something is not the same by those two measurements, even though we are after the same quantity. If we take other samples, I should say one thing first. If you want to find out about what is the quality of the graphene, and the key point here is to find out about sort of the connectivity and the quality of the whole graphene surface. And one way of doing that is by using this four-point probe technique. And then you have two different configurations. If you have these four points, I should maybe say first, for those of you who are not four-point probe experts, which is probably many of you, that the purpose of using four electrodes instead of just two to measure the conductance is that if you measure only with two electrodes, then you measure the conductance of the electrodes and the sample, or basically the contact resistance plus the sample resistance. And you don't know what is what. But if you use four electrodes and do it in the right way, then there's a whole bunch of literature that shows that, that then you can decouple the contact resistance and then you get the real sheet resistance of the sample itself. And you can do this in two configurations where you apply the voltage in the middle and read the current on the outside, or in this configuration over here. And the ratio of the resistances coming out of this should, for a perfect 2D surface, be 1.26. Long story, but this is just a fact of life, basically. And if we do this analysis on the data we have here, we see that this is not the case. This ratio is not 1.26, as it should be if it's a nice homogeneous 2D film. You see that it's, I wouldn't say it's random, but it's not the this distribution one should think. So clearly the film is not a uniform 2D film. It's broken up, basically. If we take other samples, this is a better transfer technique, but also standard CVD growth. It gets a little bit better, the conductivities get higher, and we are more centered on this diagonal here. And if we take graphene that is grown by another technique where we actually grow the graphene on single crystal copper 111 surfaces that are good lattice matched with the graphene, then the graphene becomes very, very uniform and nice. And you can see the conductivity gets higher, and the correspondence between the micro four-point probe measurements and the terahertz measurements becomes striking. It's a very nice agreement. And here you can see this the distribution diagram of the two configuration resistances up here matches perfectly with the theory of a uniform 2D film. So whether or not a DC measurement of conductance or terahertz measurement of conductance gives the same value depends on the quality of the graphene. If it's a uniform 2D surface, there's one-to-one agreement. If it's a surface which is very much broken up in smaller pieces with a lot of small domains and so on, then the terahertz measurements always gives higher value than the DC measurements. There's a lot of story behind that that I cannot tell you right now, but I think that's a nice insight at least. We can map the mobility also. I mean, what I showed you now was just the conductance or the surface conductivity, which is a macroscopic quantity that is defined by the microscopic properties, the scattering time of the carriers, the number of carriers, and such parameters. And the mobility, we can actually extract that from fitting the measured data to a model. You see that it has a spectral shape, and that means we can fit a model to it. We use the Drude model. And if you do Drude-Boltzmann transport theory on graphene, you come up with equations that relate the conductivity to the scattering time, the number of carriers, the Fermi speed, and things like that. And you can write it up, and then you can find out about that if you know the DC conductivity and you know the scattering time, which we can get from the Drude fits to these curves here, then you can find the number of carriers and the intrinsic drift mobility of the graphene here, which are quantities that otherwise are not easy to measure. And then we can make maps of it. So this is a map of a 4-inch wafer where you see the conductivity map here. It looks pretty uniform except some burn holes and transfer damage and things like that. From the theory on the past slide, we can also extract what is the scattering time here. You see the scattering time up here in femtoseconds. We can extract the number of carriers here. You see it's in numbers of 10 to 13 here. And the carrier mobility here. And of course, since we have so many data points, we can make diagrams that look like this. The conductivity has a distribution which is pretty broad. Is that because there's a big distribution of scattering times, big distribution of carrier concentration? This we don't know in advance just by looking at this here. But we can see scattering times are actually relatively narrowly spread out here. And the number of carriers is a little bit broader here. It's not super clear here now, I realize. But actually, we can learn what is the reason for the variation of the conductivity. Is it because of changes or variations in scattering time or other parameters there? Good. So basically, we have a mapping technique that can basically tell the quality of graphene based on its conductance or conductivity. So that means we can tell the people who grow the graphene, is their machine adjusted right? Does it do it right? And there's an example of that here. These are samples that we got from Grafenia, where we, which is a Spanish company that makes graphene. We asked them to produce 4-inch graphene wafers grown at different growth temperatures. And then we wanted to see what is going on. And you can see that depending on the growth temperature, and based on that, we could tell that the best growth temperature is somewhere between 1,000 and 1,025. And clearly, they could just map that out themselves with some four-point probe measurement technique or something like that. But if you don't have a contact-free method, it would be very hard to see all the, you can see all the fine structure here around here, and you can see that actually that there's a gradient in conductance between here and here, and you can see actually by looking at this picture here, the company can say, ah, this is because the gas pressure is not completely right, or we should rotate the gas valve a little bit so it's more uniform, stuff like that. So that feedback is super important. We wrote a review about this that we published recently, so if you want to know more about stuff, then you can read about it there. Good. So, just need to keep eye on time. Good. So I have to. It works. Okay, it just got blue screen, but it was blue, so that's okay. So, very briefly, I cannot give a presentation like this without going into fundamental spectroscopy, and I'll make the story short. But basically, I want to show you how we really do the spectroscopy. So this is an example of terahertz time domain spectroscopy of silicon carbide. And let me show you this diagram first, and then I'll just speed through the results. But it shows basically how we do the spectroscopy and why the terahertz time domain spectroscopy is such a useful tool compared to other spectroscopic techniques in the same range. So what you see here are two signals. There's the black one is a terahertz pulse just transmitted through the spectrometer. And in this case here, it's a very, very broadband terahertz pulse. You see it spans out to 30 terahertz at least here. So it's from this air photonics technique. And then we put in a wafer of silicon carbide, in this case a 4H one, and the signal looks like this red one here. You see that it looks very much different. Of course, it's attenuated because there's a certain absorption, there's refraction, reflection losses, and so on. But the interesting thing, and this is really the core of the time domain spectroscopy, is that you see this wonderful ringing afterwards here. This is not equipment noise or something like that. This is highly reproducible signature of the sample. And if you look at the spectrum of the transmitted pulse, the red one, you see that, it's a little bit more narrow band because silicon carbide has a big fat phonon at 25 terahertz. But you can see on top of that, there's a very, very weak and very narrow absorption line here at around 8 terahertz, which is from the sample itself also. And that very, very short feature or narrow feature in frequency corresponds to a long ringing in time. Think about the Fourier transform of a sine wave. The Fourier transform of a sine wave is just one frequency, right? So if you have one frequency missing in your spectrum, that gives a very long sinus-like ringing in time here. So this is basically just to show you how wonderful terahertz time domain spectroscopy is, because I've been doing it for the last, since 92 or so. Very long time. Anyway, the story behind it is basically that since we have this time domain technique, we can be pretty sure that if we see a feature in the spectrum, if it corresponds nicely to what we see in time, then we are sure that the feature is real and not some kind of glitch in the, if you sweep the frequency, it could be that the photodiode went off for a short moment or something like that. Well, then it's a pretty poor spectrometer. But anyway, so very briefly, 4H, the two examples I showed there, 4H and 6H silicon carbide polytypes, are basically two versions of excuse me, that would have made a lot of noise. So silicon carbide itself, in its sort of basic crystal unit cell, it has a very, very standard phonon dispersion diagram, which is shown here. You have frequency here, you have K vector out here, and you see the acoustic branches down here, you see the optical branches up here. And there are basically two optical transitions allowed. That is the TO phonon here, the transverse, and the longitudinal phonons here that corresponds to these motions shown here of the silicon and the carbide. But the 4H and the 6H polytypes are basically different stackings of silicon carbide in different patterns. And the 4H has 8 atoms per unit cell, the 6H has 12, corresponding to 21 and 33 optical modes, basically, according to standard group theory. When we do the measurements, we should see, what I should mention here also is that the TO phonon is at 24 terahertz. So there should be no absorption in silicon carbide below that, if it was just the single or the fundamental Woodside structure. But we see in the two polytypes, we see absorption, two peaks actually in the 6H and one peak in the 4H. So where do they come from? We can fit them with the Lorentz with a Lorentz model here, and we see that in the 6H we have these two distinct peaks, and 6H we have one. 4H we have one of them. So what is this? And this is basically, you can find out about what happens if you think about the dispersion diagram here of the Woodside. It says cube but that's a misprint. Of the wood side silicon carbide, it looks like this. But then when we have this layered structure that we have in 4H and 6H and the other polytypes, it corresponds to, since it's the same unit cell that we sort of copy but rotate around, then this corresponds to folding the phonon dispersion diagram. So this is folded four times, that gives us the 4H dispersion diagram. And if you fold it six times, you get the 6H dispersion diagram. And now you can see that suddenly we get a lot of infrared active modes here on K equals zero here. So vertical transitions here are the ones that we see in standard spectroscopy. So this is why we get new modes activated. And then basically if experiment fit with theory, this is what this shows here. So the mode we see in 4H is basically, it's basically an acoustic mode that gets activated by the folding. And there's one of them, and the 6H modes are the ones popping up here. That's also acoustic modes that gets folded in and gets activated by that. And the short story is basically that density functional theory and measurements fit within, you know, it just fits spot on. Very nice. Okay, so the last part is basically the sort of most, I think the most active part right now in my lab is strong field terahertz physics, terahertz plus electrons. That there's a fish. So the story about this started with an experiment we did here in 2014 or so, where we took a super simple structure. This is a silicon substrate. We put a dipole antenna on top made out of gold. It's just a rod. This is sort of the simplest metasurface you can think of, I guess. It's just a dipole antenna. It has a certain length, so it has a resonance frequency. And if we calculate what is the field distribution, if we excite this structure with a plane wave at the resonance frequency, then in the surface of this structure we get a field distribution shown here. And because of the currents that are running, or the standing wave in the rod here, we basically get a very strong field enhancement at the corners here. Up here and down here there's a very strong field enhancement. This is basically because the standing wave current drags charges away from each other, so there's a plus and a minus, so there will be a strong field. And you see the field enhancement around the corners here is like a few hundred. Okay, so we have the strong terahertz pulses, we get even further field enhancement here. What happens? And what happens is that it starts to light up in the UV. So we excite a terahertz resonance frequency dipole antenna with terahertz pulses, and then it sends out UV light. This is a map of the UV emission measured. So, what's going on there? We excite with 4 millivolts photons, and we get 4 electron volt photons out. That's quite a conversion. So, the light has this spectrum. This UV light has a spectrum shown here. So you see that this is in the UV range, and you can see that the light consists of a lot of very sharp lines. And those lines are the emission lines of a nitrogen plasma. So basically, we have nitrogen excited and nitrogen ionized. When that gas or when that plasma relaxes, it emits lights at all those frequencies here. All these indications are known lines, so it fits fine. We see that the light disappears when we pump away the atmosphere, so it is really light from a nitrogen plasma that forms around the structure. This was done in our standard lab, so just in air. So what happens here is really that we do ultrafast radiation chemistry. We have the metal here, this is the gold work function, and the vacuum level up here. And when we apply a field to this structure, we tilt the vacuum level down so electrons can tunnel out. This is just field emission. But we do it with a short terahertz pulse instead of a DC field. If you heard about attosecond science, and you may have heard a little bit about that yesterday, right? Then this is very, very close to the three-step model. that is used there. We have tunneling of electrons out, acceleration by the optical field, and then in the three-step model, we get recollision afterwards. Here, we don't necessarily get recollision, but we can act digitally, but it's the same principle. And what happens is that nitrogen molecules, neutral nitrogen molecules in the atmosphere, gets ionized or excited by the electrons that are coming out here. They come out via tunneling, and then the terahertz field is still on, so they also get accelerated to a large energy. And this is how we can get the conversion from the millivolts terahertz photons to electron volt UV photons. It's not because it's a multi-photon process, it's a field-driven process. We use the strong electric field of the terahertz signal, not the number of photons. So this is really terahertz-induced atmospheric chemistry. We could put anything else there, and we would do chemistry on that also. We can make that into a camera that I would like to skip because I'm running out of time. But basically, if we look at one of these structures one more time and see these electrons coming out, this is a simulation in CST Microwave Studio, for those of you who want to know. This is a simulation of the electron emission and path of the electrons afterwards when there's a strong terahertz field coming in on this structure. And you can see that there's a lot of things going on here. This is also at full blast, so it can be more controlled. But you basically see here's this little gap with a strong field, field enhancement. And then from this gap, we get electrons tunneling out. And then we see this distribution of electrons in space afterwards. So this is really what is going on there. Skip this one here. So basically, we can visualize these electrons. This was just a simulation, and you can tell a simulation program to give you anything you want, basically, right? If you don't have the parameters right, then you get nonsense out. So is this right? And this is a simple experiment we did where we took this field enhancement metastructure. I didn't have time to talk about that, but it's the same principle as the dipole antenna. It just gives a larger field enhancement. So we spin electron beam resist on top of it. Then we expose it to the terahertz beam, so we get electrons shooting out all over. The electrons will hit the electron beam resist, and then we develop the electron resist, and then we look at the picture afterwards. So we can see where did the electrons hit, and they hit in this beautiful circle here. So there are actually electrons coming flying out in this fountain and then crashing into the substrate again. It works very nicely, and we can visualize it like this. There's another of that here, but let me just skip that. I'd like to maybe jump to this one here that basically shows you the spectrum of these electrons. The simulation predicted kilo electron volt energies of the electrons, and we thought, that sounds very, very high, but it actually seems to be right. This is a first example of that. This is an experiment that just started working very recently. But it's basically a time-of-flight electron spectrometer where we can measure the electron energy spectra here. We excite with a terahertz pulse onto the sample, and then we measure the electron spectrum coming out here. And you can see that in this case here, it cuts off at like 400 or 500 electron volts. So we basically convert the terahertz photons from millivolt levels to hundreds of electron volts. Again, one shouldn't think about it like a photon conversion effect, but like a field-driven process, and this is why it works like this. I think I'm out of time, so this is just a picture of it. So I think I will, maybe there was three more slides, but I think I'll skip those. This is just about that we can damage materials. It's not super important. Let me just go to the conclusion. So blah, blah, blah. So what's next? There's a guy searching for something there. We have these very, very nice terahertz pulses and so on, but, and the development in the last years have shown that, okay, we can get higher and higher bandwidth, we can get higher and higher pulse energies. Where does it end? And I'm working together with people in super continuum generation, where they are very happy if they have that, like two octaves of bandwidth. It's a very nice supercontinuum. What about an extreme single cycle supercontinuum instead? This is actually the work we have done in the last few weeks, where we, instead of using a two-color air plasma in our degeneration process, we start to mix in more colors. So we have three colors here. That's the blue one here. And you can see that the standard spectrum, and that's the one I showed you with the with the silicon carbide spectroscopy was the red spectrum here. You see that it cuts off at like 25 terahertz or so. When we mix in a third color, just a little bit of a third color, then we get 100 times more power coming out. We get twice as much bandwidth. And actually, if we measure with a real spectrometer in the infrared, the spectrum spans from less than 1 terahertz, so more than 300 micrometers, up to 3 microns. And this was just the first experiment based on this. So I predict, and maybe somebody will laugh at me afterwards, but soon we will have complete terahertz infrared coverage with a single cycle terahertz pulse. Now it's not really a terahertz pulse anymore, it's just a pulse, right? With pulse energies more than 100 microjoules from a standard millijoule tabletop laser. This opens up completely new possibilities for nonlinear spectroscopy. And finally, this with the electrons coming out. We have short bunches of electrons coming out. That means that we can actually study femtosecond radiation chemistry. Radiation chemistry is the chemistry involved in understanding radiation damage to our skin, to DNA, and so on. When, for instance, cosmic rays come in and penetrate the skin, there's a lot of damage going on. That damage happens not because of the cosmic ray directly, but because of secondary electrons coming out in cascades. When the megavolt particle comes in, then there's a secondary cascade of electrons coming out, and they resonate with biomolecules at energies between 10 and 100 electron volts, which is the spectrum I just showed you a little while ago. And we have a very short pulse of those, so I hope that we will be able to, instead of doing traditional radiation chemistry where we just irradiate something for a long time and then we see afterwards what happened. Why don't we take these very short bunches of electrons, start the process, and then use femtochemistry techniques to probe the evolution of what happens in the femtoseconds afterwards? That would be really, really, really cool. So with that, I'd like to say thank you very much.
Now we have opportunity for 2 questions.
Sorry.
Yeah.
So thank you for exciting talk, and I have pretty primitive questions. So jumping back to this 18th century art, how much time does it take simply to get this perfect background picture? So you said that it's like pixel by pixel, so really, really, how much time does it take to get this really perfect layer distribution, like really see this different layer? So can you basically cover all maybe pictures in Louvre, I don't know, for 1 month either, just to see all these hidden senses?
I can say so much that it's an excellent question, and I didn't say anything about it. It takes a long time. With art, that's not critical. But I mean, scanning an area like this takes 2-3 hours or something. The last big painting I showed you, that was a stitch of 12 separate images. So that took, I mean, and we also scanned the backside and the wooden frame and all sorts of things, and that campaign took like 2 or 3 weeks or something. Measuring time the whole time. So it's not easy. And I would say the first time we had to stitch all these pieces together, that was not super trivial. I mean, that required some MATLAB skills. and of course, the first time it took a long time because we didn't really know. But the next time, we basically have the scripts in place so we can just run and adjust and run, and then it fits. But I would say measuring time is still a factor that one have to think about. Do you have access time that is long enough to do this? Or in other words, is this important enough for those who come with a painting? But I would say in most cases, if it's a museum, they have plenty of time. Doesn't matter. I mean, if it's a factory where you have to measure car paint thickness, it better work, you know, like that. But if it's, you know, in research, time is not super critical. But of course, this is something we have to work on. If somebody needs to buy an instrument and do it, or wants to buy an instrument and do it, then it should be relatively smooth. But I would say in the museum world particular, it's not super critical. Because they spend months and months on, you know, renovating paintings anyway. So when they do these campaigns, the painting is standing in some lab for many months anyway. So there's not critical, but I'm not, I hope I don't sound like I don't care about how long time it takes, because it's nicer if it's faster, definitely. but this is up to the people who make very good hardware and software also.
Final question. Yeah.
I would like to thank you for your nice presentation also.
Thank you.
The first part was very interesting to see. I would like to ask about second part, some technical questions.
Yeah.
You made a picture of graphene sheet. Was it on silicon carbide substrate?
No, this was on silicon dioxide on silicon.
Okay.
So an SiO2, this standard few hundred nanometer, right?
And in which frequency was it?
The terahertz images are typically at, let's say, 0.8 terahertz or something. It's a broadband signal, and the way we visualize it is either that we extrapolate the conductivity spectrum to low frequencies and use that value, or we specify that this is an average between 0.8 and 0.9 terahertz or something.
May I one? Sure. the huge spectra you showed at the end,
yeah.
What is the resolution of that?
The resolution depends on how long your time window is. Mm-hmm. And I would say if we use this air plasma technology, then there's nothing that stops us from making very long windows, except, you know, the time it takes doing it. Normally, we are always limited by, you know, multiple reflections in substrates or in the generator or in the receiver or something like that. And this is not the case here, because both the generator and the detector is just an air plasma, so there are no internal echoes there that we would like to cut away. But I would say in practice, I mean, since we have to scan this huge bandwidth, that means the time step gets very small. If you want to scan 100 or want to measure 100 terahertz, then we need to have step sizes of maybe, you know, 1 micron or something like that or less. And that means scanning two centimeters suddenly takes a very long time. And I can see in our own labs, we typically run out of patience at maybe 10 picoseconds or something like that, which is a resolution of 100 gigahertz.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you, Peter. It was fantastic. Thank you.
You.